Yeah, Father John was praying over me beforehand. He's a Spartan. Yeah, he was at MSU when I was there. So as soon as he said that, I said, pray for me. Actually, he should have prayed for you. But you're the ones getting me inflicted on you. So, let's try that again. Okay. When we talk about remember the alert and oriented thing? Yeah, because if you didn't, you need help. That was just like an hour ago, all right? Alert and oriented. What do we need to be woke up to? And what is it that throws us off so often is us forgetting that God loves us and all of the conclusions that come from that. What I want us to do is I want to give us an idea, okay? Something that we can all strive for to be truly alive. And it starts with, I was driving my truck, and I was heading, I had three churches, right? So I would pray mass, I'd process out, I'd get in my truck, drive to the next one in my vestments. I got pulled over once, and I was like, no, I wear a dress, officer. I'm sorry. That's how it is. Let's do this. So drive to the next one. When I walk in, they start the opening song, right? Pray that mass. Hustle out, do this. I'm driving, I'm listening to this talk. And it was a guy named Dr. Peter Kraft, one of my favorite humans. And he said this. He said, if you think about it, there's only one reason you're not a saint. You don't want to be. And I literally had to pull over the truck. I'm like, no, there's another reason, right? Maybe it's that I'm not too bright. That would be a good reason to not be a saint. There's only one reason that we're not saints. And it's because we don't want to be. Because we have everything we need, truly. The power that raised Jesus from the dead, it lives in us. All that we need is present, except the desire. And so why don't I have that desire? I had the desire to be a saint in the sense that I would like to go to heaven. Hell seems like a very bad thing, yeah? No? Okay, there's a couple of, well, I don't know. I don't make judgments. I want to go to heaven. I love God. But being a saint, that seems hard. Yeah? It seems hard. And so as I thought about it, the first thing that struck me was I was worried that pursuing sainthood would mean I would become unrecognizable to myself. That I would have to so radically alter myself that I would get lost in the process. And there's a couple things there that the Lord started working on. And the first one was, well, getting lost, it's not so much getting lost, it's, and I'm sorry for the cliche, it's getting found. This is what you were made for. Now, I'm a spacey man, and if you put me on an elevator and the doors open, I'll get off. I'll just assume that's my floor, yeah? And have you ever done this where you get off at the wrong floor and you have that magic moment of, do I want everyone in there to know I'm an idiot, right? Or do I just want to wait a respectful amount of time for the next cart, yeah? I'm a get right back in there because I'm clear on who I am, and I'd like them to know too. But a lot of our life is that feeling of getting off on the wrong floor. We're that close. But it's because it's in us. It's hardwired into our spiritual DNA that we are supposed to live for something besides ourself. And we have those magic days where every once in a while we get to do what we want in the way we want. And it's nice. But after a few of those, what we want becomes our master. We find ourselves enslaved to what we want. And what we want changes. What we will sacrifice everything for one year might be gone from our hearts the next. It's because we weren't made for that. We weren't made to please ourselves. We weren't made to bend reality around us and our needs. We were made for something great. We were made to live for God and for others. And that's where we will find joy. What will get lost if we pursue sainthood? The stuff we don't need. the stuff we don't want. That kind of moral, spiritual insanity that we all share of, I know I should do this, and I know I'm not going to. Right? That broken part inside of each of us. What do we do about it? St. John Paul II had, and I met him one time. It was in Rome. He lived there. I was kind of surprised. But I got to meet him. And the thing I'll never forget was from something he wrote actually before he was Pope. He said that if you want to be saint, you have to recognize that what you feel, feelings, are something you need to take, this is what he said, to the classroom of your mind. You need to discipline and educate your feelings so that you act like you wish you felt. So that you act like you wish you felt. And that is really something to try. To try to act like we wish we felt. According to St. John Paul II, that's how you become a saint. He flat out wrote that. Learn to act like you wish you felt. What does that look like? Pretty interesting, yeah? So what does it look like? I can think of a billion examples of the times where I'm walking up to the church and there are 932,000 people waiting to tell me the most important thing that I need to know that moment, yeah? No? Do you guys do this to your priests? Yeah? Oh, yeah, it's wonderful. So you're trying to get in there to pray Mass, and I'm trying to, what my nephew called, get my pray on. Yeah, that's what he calls it. I'm trying to get my prey on. And instead, I'm getting hit with really important stuff like, Father, there's still a Lenten flyer on the bulletin board. And that's, you know, you can take it down. Jesus will allow that. Yeah, you don't need me here. All these kind of things, right? And what do I want to do? I want to flee like it's a crime scene. Yeah, I want to get out of there. But that's not, oh, thank you. I've been to some crime scenes. That's not going to help anyone. That's just what I feel. And I know that the best moments in my life are when people actually stopped and listened to what I was worried about. So that's what I act on, what I wish I felt. I wish I felt like the priest I want to be, so I'll act like that. It's a thing that's a great discipline, because it starts to pull us out of the world of what we want, that self-obsession we all have, and right into the world of what others need. And as challenging as it is to start, it's almost impossible to stop, because a part of you will immediately recognize, I was made for this. I was made for this. I was made for others. A key to that, of course, is to pray, because that requires more strength than you and I have. That requires much more than we have. And that's why prayer is so important. And I'm going to talk for a bit about that now. Okay. So there's two kinds of prayer, personal prayer and communal prayer. And we're going to talk a little bit about personal prayer. And it's crazy. This just on the way here, right? Dad and I were driving from Flint, and we decided to leave a little early and take not highways, right? We'll just drive, what's that one road? Dixie Road, because there's lakes. So we'll stare at those as we go, and we'll look for cars. So as we were driving, massive accident in front of us. So what do? We prayed. Right? Jesus blessed those people, whoever was involved in that. Jesus blessed the first responders. Jesus blessed those who are ministering to them. We really took a couple minutes and we did a serious prayer. We saw a need and we prayed for it. And our lives can be filled with those. Now, I don't know, this is Sterling Heights, right? And I don't know Sterling Heights well, but I live in Flint. So my rule was always, when I hear a siren, I pray. In Flint, you hear a lot of sirens, more than you don't. And Jesus at one point was like, dude, chill, I get it, right? He was so sick of hearing from me. Okay, he didn't say chill. But this guy's, every time there is a constant crying out in the universe for prayer, and God can use us to meet that need. We're all aware of what we need. We are. And in fact, I'd suggest we're probably a little too aware of it. But God wants us to point our spiritual eyes outward and look and see at the needs that we encounter. Seeing someone by themselves, seeing someone who might be homeless or incredibly poor, seeing someone, you've seen that, where you're walking and you see someone walking by and just that distressed or harried look, right? Jesus, bless them. We can constantly be praying, quite literally, because there is constant need. This pulls us away from ourselves and our self-focus. And again, it's counterintuitive, but it will awaken our soul, because that's what we're made for. This is what we're made for. When we encounter any situation, we can see in it an invitation to prayer. And that's not just external, it's also internal. So me, I'm a world-class worrier, okay? If worrying was a charism, I would find a religious order. I don't want to brag. I worry, I seriously have spent time worrying about how much I worry. Thank you. It's a lifelong skill. And my confessor, who's gonna go to heaven just for being my confessor, he gave me a penance one time. He said, here's your penance. And he did the point, and I said, oh no. He said, every time you worry, I want you to turn it into a prayer. Every worry that enters your head, turn it into a prayer. Use your neuroses toward holiness. He's a jerk. I'm still working on it. It's going to take a long time because it's taken me years to get this insane, right? But I'm getting better. I'm noticing more and more, as soon as worry starts to enter the skull, turn it into a prayer. Turn it into a prayer. If you are a worrier, you know what I'm talking about. Can you imagine if you prayed every time you worried? You would be in constant prayer. It's remarkable. And again, is it hard? Yeah, but we were made for this. We were made for it. And the more we practice it, the more we'll see it. We've tried the other stuff, right? We've tried the foot in the pool with Jesus, right? Jesus has tons of fans. He needs followers, right? Fanning Jesus, being Jesus' fan, whatever, right? But there are easier clubs. But being Jesus' follower, that'll light a fire in you that nothing can put out. Why? It's what you were made for. It's why you were created. Our prayer can also and should also be prayers of gratitude. I've come to see 21 years of priesthood that I think gratefulness is probably one of the most important traits a saint can have. A saint is grateful. A saint is content. A saint is aware of how blessed they are. There's a guy, and of course his name just fell out of my skull, but he runs a retreat center for priests. And he came, Rossetti, wow, there we go, it came back in. Lots of room. Rossetti is a priest who runs a retreat facility for other priests. And he was given a talk, and he talked about how when priests come to his retreat center, it's because they had to come, right? It's because their bishop said, hey, good news, you're going on retreat. So they get there, and he says they're burnt out, they're beat up, and they're tired. They've been chewed up and spit out. And he says, and the first thing I tell him is put your stuff down. The Blessed Sacrament's right over there. Go sit in the chapel with Jesus and write down why you love being a priest. When you're done, come on out. And he said, there are guys who are in there for about 20 minutes. And then they come out. And he says, we enroll them in a six-week program. Yeah? He said, but then there are guys I have to keep going in and check, and page after page, and they're crying. And he says, and I always think, they just need sleep. right? They're fine. They're filled with gratitude. They'll be okay. They're just tired. Gratitude and awareness of how ridiculously blessed we are. The problem is our brains are hardwired to remember pain. It is not hard to remember pain. If I said write down the three most painful things that have happened to us, our trouble would generally be picking three, because we remember wounds. But we need to make a conscious effort to remember what our God has done, to remember the blessing of what we have and who God is. I was talking back to, who was that? Somebody came over. So tomorrow, you know, is the birthday of the Blessed Mother, yeah? Well, that was my mother's birthday too, okay? She was number 14, and she had three, there are three girls in that family who shared the birthday with the Blessed Mother, okay? Yeah, oh yeah. So I was, 17, 18 when I did the math. That's when you start to become aware that mom and dad exist. Yeah, you know, outside of need fulfillment, you know. And I said, Ma, this is a true story. You share a birthday with a Blessed Mother. I was just, wow. And she said, yeah. You know, I said, do you know what that makes me? And she said, dead at 33. Didn't even pause. Seriously, she was like, boom. Man. But she did. But she was an incredible prayer. Every morning, I know, yeah. Every morning, I'd get up and I would see her sitting in her prayer chair with her Bible and her journal, just getting after it. Just getting after it. And I'm so grateful for that. I'm ridiculously grateful for her. I'm grateful for my dad. There was one time we were kids and snow made school get canceled, right? So there was no school, and we were out in the sticks. So we were the last place to get plowed, okay? And we were out playing in the yard, and my dad came home every day at 3:10 p.m., right? He was at working over at the Chevy plant. Every day, 3:10, man walked in the door, okay? Well, we're out there playing in the yard, and it's after 3:10. They haven't plowed the road yet. The road is deep in snow. And all of a sudden, I look, and there he is walking through the snow on his way home, right? The guy he rode with couldn't get down the road. So Dad was walking. And even at a little guy, I got just for a second, as much as a little guy could, wow, that's for us. Right? He's not getting up every morning because he's like, I love Chevy. Yeah, right? It wasn't every morning. It wasn't, I can't wait to go into work. You know, it was, he loved us and he took care of us. And that's pretty crazy. That made me blessed. I could go through family member after family member, but I've only got three more hours. You know, think of those times in the past when you've prayed and you thought it couldn't get worse, and here you are, and be grateful. Be grateful. Be grateful. Saints pray, and a lot of that prayer is praying for others, turning the internal things toward prayer, and at the same time recognizing the blessings of the people around you. You are, I can almost guarantee that your priest, whoever he is grateful for you. I can't tell you how many Sundays I'll be out there praying Mass and I'll look around and I know that person and that person. I know what they're going through. I know what they're struggling with. And I can't believe they're sitting there. I can't believe it. And my heart is full. My heart is filled with gratitude. Gratitude can heal a lot of wounds. And gratitude can help us recognize what we forget so easily because we're hardwired to remember pain. But this is how saints were made. Is it easy? No. But once we start, we'll see that this is what we were made for. Saints also are people who get out and focus, change focus, I guess, is the best way to put it. That our flesh wants us to make sure we are served, right? And to make sure that other people basically function around that, okay? What Jesus wants us to do is turn the desire to change inward and the desire to serve outward. He wants to work against that broken thing in us that wants service to go inward and change to go outward. I can't tell you how often I hear what those people need to do. Right? How often, if he or she would just blah, blah, blah. We've got the list of how if other people would just listen to us, really, it would be better. But the need to change, the hunger for things to change, we need to turn internal. Change here. Let God change the inside and let our desire for service go that way. Instead of looking at other people and saying how they need to change, we'll look inside and say, how can I change? What does God want to change in me? Because here's the key. You're the only thing God gave you to control. That's it. God only gave you to control. That's it. So focus that internally. Focus that internally to getting rid of all of those things that will wound others. Remember Jesus said, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Meek, it means to refuse to do harm to others. Isn't that beautiful? To refuse to do harm to others. And, sorry? Oh, okay, yeah. We need to refuse to do harm to others. And we need to change whatever's in us that hurts others. Even if it's by accident, we can work through it. We can change that by the power of the Holy Spirit and then turn it towards service of others. Instead of getting them to change and serve me, we change, we serve them, because that's what Jesus did for us, right? It says, St. Paul wrote this, even while we hated him, he loved us and died for us. Look at what he said on the cross. While we were killing him, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. He was making excuses for us while we were killing him. This kind of heart is one God has given us. And again, it's hard, guys. It's tough. But once we start, we'll see that it's what we're made for. Now, these are tough things. These are challenging things. Because if being a saint was easy, we'd have a lot more of them. But here's the key. We're not doing it on our strength. Our strength is not sufficient. We have access at all times to the power that raised Jesus from the dead. So one of the most common things we can be saying over and over in our head and in our heart and in dialogue is, come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Calling on that Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. C.S. Lewis talked about this at one point, that one of the things that turned him to, opened his heart to the possibility of Christianity was when someone challenged him to read the Gospels, so he did. And what struck him was something, this would have never occurred to me because I was raised with Jesus, right? We've been friends for a while. He says, who makes up a story about the Son of God coming to earth? And I'm going to tell you the story of my time with him. And when I tell you that, you'll become convinced I'm an idiot. He says, who would do that? Look at the disciples who wrote these Gospels. It's not as if they were the brightest. Every time they spoke, almost, Jesus had to, right? One of them sold him. Another one denied knowing him. And they all but one ran away from him. Who makes that up? Who says, I'm one of the appointed shepherds of God, and here's my story. I'm not bright, and I'm a coward. Nobody would do that. But you look at those stories, and you look at, and what you see, a consistent pattern in the Gospels, the disciples want to get it right, but they can't. They can't. Thomas got it right more times than not, which is really kind of interesting, isn't it? Jesus said, remember, he has that great dialogue with Peter, where Peter says, you're the Christ, the Son of God. And Jesus says, blessed are you, Simon, son of John. Mere flesh didn't reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. And so I tell you, you're rock. And on this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of the netherworld won't prevail against it. And then he tells them, now we are going to Jerusalem. And when we get there, I'm going to be arrested and tortured and killed, and on the third day rise. And what's Peter's line? Well, let's not go to Jerusalem. Right? That's what I would have said. Hey, Jericho's lovely this time of year. Right? We're going there today. Jesus says what? Get behind me, Satan. Like right after Peter hits a home run, he strikes out. I mean, there was a verse gap between those two. And did Jesus then say, Peter, you're out. We're going to move someone else to the number one position. So I changed your name to Rock. Now it's going to be Billy. Yeah. Looks so. Thomas, what did he say? Let's go die with him. Let's go die with him. Okay. So these disciples, they had the desire. Jesus flat out said it to Peter later. When Peter said, I'll never deny you, Jesus said, your spirit's willing, but your flesh is weak. And even when they knew he was risen from the dead, they stayed locked in the upper room. So how do those guys become the 11 disciples who went out and lit the world on fire? Ridiculously brave, ridiculously wise. The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit took that desire to be holy and turned it into reality. And so when we look at these things that we absolutely need to do in order to discover why we exist, they're impossible without the power of the Holy Spirit. They're impossible without it. So we need to call on that Holy Spirit whenever we need the strength, whenever we need the wisdom, whenever we lack the love, we can call on the Holy Spirit and trust that the Lord comes running. Because if there's anything that's clear, it's that our pain and our lack is an absolute magnet for Jesus. If we look at the Gospel of Matthew, there's a passage where Jesus has just done a miracle, told the disciples, get on the boat, I'll meet you on the other side of the lake. And as they go out on the lake, a big storm hits, and Jesus is walking on the water. And in one of my favorite passages in the scripture, it says, Jesus walked as if to and passed them by. Like he wasn't even going, dudes, look at this, right? I'm walking on water. He was just going to pass by them. And I think that's hilarious. But anyway, you don't? Yeah, if I'm walking on water, I'm going to be like, fellas, check this out, you know? But they're in the boat, and it says when they saw him, it says, they krazoed, that's the word in Greek, K-R-A-Z-O. They made a shrill, piercing cry like a crow makes. And when they made that noise, that awful, piercing sound, the very next line is, immediately, Jesus said, don't be afraid. And then when Peter sees it might be Jesus, if it's you, tell me to get out of the boat and walk. And then Jesus says, come to me. And Peter gets out of the boat and starts to walk on the water. And I was at a talk, I got to tell you, in high school, this priest was saying, and then he lacked faith, so he sank. I'm like, dude, even if he did 3 steps, I'm really impressed, you know? This guy was griping that he started to lose faith and sink. I'm like, 3 steps and he's in the Hall of Fame. What are you talking about? But so Peter starts walking to him, but then it says he saw the waves, he saw how turbulent the seas were, and he started to sink, and then what did he do? Krazo. He cried out. He made the shrill, piercing sound of a crow, and what's the next line? Immediately, Jesus reached out and grabbed his arm. That when we krazo, he comes. When we hit the wall of our inadequacies and that the desire for holiness isn't strong enough to translate into action, we cry out and he comes and he helps. And this is the gift of the Holy Spirit that each of us have. So as we fight this fight against the forces in us that want to focus on making all those people change, and make sure I'm served. And as we change that to I'm going to make sure I serve them and that I change. When we run into that wall, we call on Jesus. We call on the Holy Spirit. We remember the disciples and how radically they changed when the Holy Spirit got a hold of them. Come, Holy Spirit. I don't know. I was going to tell you a funny story, but I'll let it go. So what I'm going to invite us to do, and I know we've got confessions going. We've got time with Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. If you can, I'm asking you. It is really worth it. Okay. Ask God to wake up your soul and show you what you were made to be. What did you make me to be, Lord? Because I taught high school, I taught at MSU where Jesus went to school, and one of the things I saw over and over was this process, right? And you'd sit down and you'd talk to kids, and sometimes they were almost contemptuous of education, and for good reason. What we call education tends to be hoop jumping, yeah? But here they were, they grew up, and they started this phase in their life when they were a little kid, and it lasted for some time, and here's how it goes. Wake up earlier than you want, to go a place that you don't want to be, and do things that you don't want to do, and then afterwards you can come home. Right? We call that school. Yes. And so that they wake up earlier than they want to go to a place they don't want to be, to do things they don't want to do. And why are they doing it? Well, so that you can go to more school. Yeah? You'll get taller. Okay? You'll get taller. And then when you're 18, you're actually going to give tens of thousands of dollars every year so that you can wake up earlier than you want to wake up, to go to a place you don't want to be, to do a thing you don't want to do. Why are you doing that? Well, it's very simple. Because at the end of that, I get a piece of paper. And that piece of paper allows me to scratch and claw and fight for another situation where I will wake up earlier than I want to. Yeah? You with me? To go a place I don't want to go, to do something I don't want to do, so that I can get small green pieces of paper. So we'd sit there in a high school class. I'd walk them through, and they're like, oh, my Lord. I says, it gets better. Yeah? Why do you want those little green pieces of paper? Well, then we can buy stuff. What do you want? You know, the house, the dog, and the 1.5 kids. Yeah? And so I would always say, okay, so you're here in a place you don't want to be, doing something you don't want to do, so that you can someday have what your parents have. Yes. And then I ask them, are you happier than your parents? They are. Right? They are, because it's easier. So, do we leave school? Some should. I've got a list. No, what we recognize is that that's not why we're alive. That's to service why we are alive. I don't exist to have a job, to make money, to buy stuff that I don't need and that won't make me happy. I exist to light the world on fire for Christ. I exist to love and serve Him and others. And the job and the school help me do it better. That's why we're here. When I was, so do this, hey? We can do this. If five people here agree, I'm going to be a saint, and I mean it, we'll change the universe. And if you don't believe me, in my lifetime, St. John Paul II, yeah, and St. Teresa of Calcutta, we got two. And sweet, fancy Moses, they did a great job, didn't they? What if there were five? What if there were five people in this room? And I mean it. This is not a pep talk. This is what you're made for. Here's the pep talk. You ready? Because it's one of my favorite things. At MSU. Oh, wow, I've never thought of that. Yeah, Jesus did go there. That's great. I've never thought of that. Got money for you afterwards. My favorite moment there, okay, was before every game. Stand in the tunnel, okay, and what you know is in a minute, they're going to blow that gate open. You're going to run out on the field, and it's going to be insane. Yeah. And it's going to be nuts. And so while you're in the tunnel, it's pretty dark. You can see the little half light, the half circle of light somewhere in the, but you're packed in with a bunch of very, very large angry men. And the ground is shaking because there's 86,000 people, right? And they're banging on the floor of the stadium and they're screaming. And every cell in your body is on fire at that point. You almost feel bad for the people who are waiting for you out there. It will light you on fire. And then they let you run out there, and it's an explosion of sound and light and energy that will just blow you away. That is the reality that I'll never forget. And I think of it, I do. In hard moments, I think of that because it, Hebrews, right? Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us cast aside every encumbrance of sin and everything that prevents us and press forward with our eyes fixed on Jesus. The angels and the saints are shaking the floor right now, and they're telling you, we're here. It's worth all your blood, all your sweat, all your breath. It's what you're made for. And we're going to do it because it's what we were made for, and we've tried the other stuff. We've tried foot in the water Christianity, and it stinks. We've tried the half in, half out. We've tried the play nice and share your toys version of Christianity. It doesn't work. We were made to be saints, and the saints are telling us that, and they're praying for us. So I'll invite all of us to take this challenge tonight. As we get our time with Jesus, let him awaken that soul. It was made to shine with his light and change the world. We will be men and women of prayer. We will be men and women of service and of sacrifice. And every day we will go to war with all that stuff in there that wants us, points us toward what's less and what's temporary. We'll be the saints God made us to be. Amen?
Amen.
Okay.